Welcome back to New World Next Week. I'm James Corbett of CorbettReport.com.
And I'm James Evan Pilato of MediaMonarchy.com. Israeli company helps the FBI hack the iPhone and the open source Brussels investigation. Those stories. But first, Japan ships weapons-grade plutonium back to the U.S. We grabbed this story from Reuters a few days ago. Japan will load weapons-grade plutonium onto a ship as early as this weekend to send to the United States in what will be the largest such shipment of the highly dangerous material since 1992. Greenpeace announced this last Friday. The shipment of 331 kilograms of plutonium, enough to make about 50 nuclear weapons, will be loaded in Tokaimura, northeast of Tokyo, onto the Pacific Egret, an armed British ship, and transported to the U.S. Department of Energy's Savannah River site in South Carolina. Shipments of plutonium are highly sensitive because the material can be used in advanced nuclear weapons or as a so-called dirty bomb. In Japan, public sensitivity is also high because the country is the only nation to be bombed with nuclear weapons. The U.S. Embassy in Tokyo declined to comment, but the shipment is a tiny portion of the nearly 50 tons of plutonium Japan holds. Most of Japan's plutonium comes reprocessing spent nuclear fuel burned in the country's reactors. All but two of Japan's reactors have been shut down, of course, since Fukushima nearly now over, rather, 5 years ago. The plutonium being shipped was supplied by the United States, the United Kingdom, and France for the Japan Atomic Energy Agency's Fast Critical Assembly Project in Tokaimura, according this to the International Panel on Fissile Materials. The agreement to transfer the material to the U.S. was reached back in March of 2014, and a spokesman at the Japanese Atomic Agency declined to comment. So that story, James, tells a more complete story, but I have a more recent article that we'll include in the show notes that shows, guess what? The ship has already sailed. It sailed yesterday, March 22nd, as we are taping this on March 23rd, 2016. So, James, we often talk about trains carrying, you know, tar and oil and all these other things. We're surrounded by potential disasters, aren't we?
We are. And there's so many different nuggets in this story, one of which being that the 331 kilograms of plutonium in question here is a tiny fraction, as this article admits, of the 50 tons of weapons-grade plutonium that Japan has. And this 331 kilograms was supplied as part of this program, supposedly, blah, 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 and that's why it's being shipped back. What about the rest of the 50 tons of weapons-grade plutonium? Where did it come from? Why does Japan, a nuclear weapons-free country, one that's obviously completely forsworn nuclear weapons and has made a big deal of that on the international stage for many, many, many decades, for obvious reasons, why do they have weapons-grade plutonium? How did they get that weapons-grade plutonium in the first place? If you are interested in those questions, I have answers. Interview 501 that I conducted back 4 years ago with Joe Trento of the National Security News Service, where we talked about his 20-plus year investigation into the completely, utterly illegal and secret program between the Japan and the U.S. That started in the Reagan era in the 1980s to provide Japan with plutonium separation technology, breeder reactor research, and access to the Savannah and Hanford nuclear sites in the United States. An extremely important story. I hope people will rewatch that interview and read the report itself. Again, a 20-plus year investigation that uncovered all the documents into that. Again, completely illegal program. Totally broke U.S. laws, Japanese laws, and international treaties about the handling of such materials and technologies. But there you go, folks. The entire Japanese nuclear energy industry was and is a cover for a nuclear weapons program. And that is 100% laid out in that article. So that's what is underlying this story. That's the excluded piece that they're not going to talk about. And oh, by the way, the NSNS, the National Security News Service, estimate at the time of the 2012 report was that Japan had 70 tons of plutonium, not 50.
And you mentioned Hanford. That's, of course, making a big mess up here in the Pacific Northwest area. And we've talked to guys both, I think, at Media Monarchy, and even when I used to produce Ground Zero, we talked to some folks from the Hanford Challenge. So again, we'll include those show notes just like we include everything that we note on these episodes down in the show notes. And our second story this week, James, is the one now everybody is talking about. Israel's Cellebrite revealed as company helping FBI hack iPhone encryption. This comes, of course, from Zero Hedge in the aftermath of the FBI's surprising request this past Monday to postpone a hearing in its legal crusade to unlock Apple's cell phones, many wondered who it was that had succeeded in penetrating the supposedly unhackable smartphone. Earlier today, Reuters provided the answer. The FBI's effort is being assisted by Israel's Cellebrite, a provider of mobile forensic software which is now helping the feds in their attempt to unlock an iPhone used by one of the San Bernardino, California shooters. This all reported today by the Yedioth Ahronoth newspaper in Israel. If Cellebrite succeeds, then the FBI will no longer need the help of Apple Incorporated, the Israeli Daily said, citing unnamed industry sources. It will also mean that the entire Apple stand for privacy and consumer rights was one big, shocking, theatrical spectacle, as both parties involved were clearly aware the iPhone can be penetrated, but all it takes are the right tools, and wouldn't you know it, those right tools have been found in Israel. This becomes a recurring mantra. Cellebrite officials declined to comment on the matter. So, Cellebrite, James, I knew it was all those... Wait a second. They're a subsidiary of a Japanese corporation called Suncorp. Cellebrite, a subsidiary of Japan's Suncorp, has its revenue split between two businesses, a forensic system used by law enforcement, military, and intelligence that retrieves data hidden inside mobile devices and technology for mobile retailers. The development could bring an abrupt end to the high-stakes legal showdown, which has been a lightning rod for a broader debate on data privacy in the U.S., coincidentally after Apple's latest big product announcement, which was, for all intents and purposes, a major dud. James, but they're going to have nylon watch bands on the new watches. How could that announcement have been a dud? So, since I've been doing the new morning show every morning here, I find it becomes that much easier then, in some ways, to stay on top of the news. And I realized when all this news broke today, Cellebrite, it's like, Cellebrite, I covered that actually over a week ago on the Morning Monarchy, because John Young of Cryptome.org had a breakdown on Cellebrite's massive extraction abilities. And I even went back to MediaMonarchy.com and searched the archives and found a story as far back as September 2014 with the title, "The Police Tool That Pervs Use to Steal Nude Pics from Apple's iCloud." And if that's not enough, the Chicago Tribune just reported today Johns Hopkins researchers have poked holes in Apple's encryption. So, James, I believe you have recently explained the Apple FBI PSYOP, have you not?
I have, in an editorial for the International Forecaster that's up on my website, and the International Forecaster's website will throw in the link so people can read it for themselves. The long story short is that, of course, this was a PSYOP from the very beginning. The U.S. government does not need Apple to help in any way to collect the data from that phone because they already have it on the NSA servers. We know this because it was revealed live on, I think it was Fox News, in the wake of the Boston bombing. They said, oh yeah, they've been reviewing the phone calls and the messages on the alleged bomber's phone. And they said, well, how did they have that? Oh, the NSA has all of that. They're monitoring it all. That is how NSA whistleblowers like William Binney and others discovered. That's how they knew that the NSA, okay, they've got that operational now. They are collecting all the data in real time. So any data that was sent from that phone, the NSA already has on their servers. They don't need any sort of, you know, jiggery-pokery to unlock that phone, even if they needed the jiggery-pokery to unlock the phone, which they don't, again, because the NSA, for example, has bragged in their internal documents about having complete mastery over the iPhone with, you know, 30 different injections that they can use whatsoever, you know, blah, blah, blah. So again, it's all PSYOP. It is just to get it into the public consciousness. So it's, you know, it's valiant Apple fighting for your privacy versus the U.S. government. And now that the DOJ is going to walk away from the case and say, oh, okay, you know what, we don't need Apple to help us, then everyone will stop thinking about it and go, oh, okay, the iPhone's safe, don't worry. So that's going to be the takeaway message from all of this, and it's all a lie. As for the Israel slash Japanese connection to the story, it's interesting. I assume to yourself and a lot of the informed listeners in our audience, all I'd have to say is Converse, Infosys, Amdocs, Odigo. But for people who need that spelled out in more detail, I'll throw in a link in the show notes talking about Carl Cameron's expose on Fox News back in the wake of 9/11 and how that the Israeli companies 100% nested into the infrastructure, the technological infrastructure of the telecom systems in the United States. Absolutely 100% has been, was, and presumably still is spying on everything that's passing through the U.S. wires. So for people who need a refresher on that or who haven't heard about it before, I'll throw in the link in the show notes.
Well, and that is actually, I hadn't even thought about that. That Carl Cameron report from Fox is landmark. I mean, and now that's going back over a decade ago. And so that's actually two notes you just made there to Fox News breaking important news.
Probably the only two, but still, there you go.
So our third and final story this week, James, in some way is just kind of a roundup. And unfortunately, you know, it came Tuesday morning, 3:22. I had not only my mom, but also Cassie both text me and say, you said something was going to happen on March 22nd. How did you know? I was like, sadly, in a lot of ways, it's not that difficult. And when you follow the work of even people like Lauren Coleman of Copycat Effect, he had put out many, many times these dates, these signs, these symbols probably point to something going down on March 22nd. So the top of this, James, will just include your open thread on the Brussels attacks. And you have just posted that very recently. So there's still a lot more info to be added in there. However, probably at the top of the heap in a lot of ways, Turkey's Erdogan warned of attacks in Brussels 4 days before the event took place. In an instance of bizarre timing or perhaps foreknowledge, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan warned Europe only 4 days ago that it could see terrorist bombings and attacks in its cities in the near future if it does not cease support for and cooperation with Kurdish militants. Interestingly enough, Erdogan mentioned Brussels as a potential target by name. So he said, quote, there is no reason why the bomb that exploded in Ankara cannot explode in Brussels or any other European city. The snakes you are sleeping with can bite you anytime, end quote. So, James, some of the other stories people are floating around today, of course, the bombers were known militants deported from Turkey to Europe, and some other interesting things about some of the CCTV footage purporting to be from the airport attack. Then they find out later, it's like, wait, that's a 2011 footage from Moscow. So even our friend Brock West on Twitter noted, which brings in some ways a lot of this full circle before knowing any details, a lot of the polls rush to blame encryption for the Brussels attacks. James, your take on this?
Well, I mean, Erdogan coming out 4 days before it saying, you know, this could happen in Brussels does seem like a threat to me, especially because this does line up very well for Turkey, who is, I think, deathly afraid of the idea of peace talks going much further in Syria at the moment, because partition is on the table and the idea of a Kurdish state of some sort being carved out there is at least being floated, if not considered seriously. And that is anathema to Turkey. So I think Erdogan, you know, he certainly called that attack, didn't he? And oh, as it turns out, one of the bombers, yeah, deported from Turkey. And we know Turkey has been up to its eyeballs in supporting Islamic State and terrorist insurgency generally in Syria. So there's a lot of connections there. And well, we know that Turkey has also planned on the record about false flag attacks in order to draw in NATO into Syria. So there's so much going on there that I think there, where there's smoke, there's fire. And hopefully people will continue to uncover that in the open source investigation, the open thread that I have there at CorbettReport.com. Link in the show notes again if you haven't seen it yet. However this plays out, whatever is going to unfold from here, I have a bold prediction that this is going to result in further crackdown on freedoms and liberties. It's going to involve more military-type police presence at airports. Who knows what kind of security procedures they're going to install. This is going to be all over the Western world for sure within the coming weeks. So this is another big, big move towards the destruction of your liberties. And that's what this is ultimately about. Blame it on the scary bearded Muslim boogeymen, and don't ever, 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 ever talk about the funding and the supplies and the arming and the training and all of the ways that this has literally been built up by the West, admitted by the former head of the Defense Intelligence Agency. Islamic State was part of a deliberate attempt to foster such a thing by the White House. This isn't even disputed by people in positions of power now. And people may try in vain to extenuate the matter, but gentlemen, I say there is no peace. The war is actually begun. The next gale that sweeps from Europe will bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here idle? What is it that gentlemen wish? What would they have? Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.
That's from this day in history, my friends. So very good there, James. And I think even Ben Swan just put up a video showing, of course, the documents. It was like the Pentagon wanted the rise of ISIS. He's getting that kind of information out on the aforementioned Fox News. And one last kind of twilight language note, and another story people are talking about with regards to the Brussels attacks. A Mormon named Mason who survived Boston, then Paris, and now Brussels, which in a lot of ways really defies belief. And again, we will include the show notes to everything we note here so you can go do more research for yourself. James, this is always that point where we need a little bit of good news, and I've been making Good News Next Week episodes every week as part of the spinoff from New World Next Week, where we have to note ways we're winning and some of the positives. So General Mills to put GMO labels on its GM cereals, and in a lot of ways, I know people have stopped buying that stuff anyway, but it shows just how much an effect it's really been having. Another good news note from our buddy Brock West, Netherlands closes 5 more prisons due to falling crime rate. Now, some of the other stories we're watching submitted by you using hashtag New World Next Week. Security researcher who investigated the Bangladesh bank hack goes missing. And breaking news just a few hours ago, alleged sex abuse victim may testify at Dennis Hastert's sentencing. And U.S. lectures Cuba on human rights across from our own torture dungeon. And modern warfare has changed forever as laser weapons are now ready for use. James, it's no real accident we named the show New World Next Week. And hopefully each week we give a little bit of a glimpse of what's really going on with a little bit of subtext and a lot of context.
And speaking of a glimpse, you're getting the first live video of my new abode here with the boxes still unpacked and still in the midst of getting everything unpacked. But I am covering and following this Brussels story. I'm about to talk to Sibel Edmonds as we record this, and there's going to be a conversation up there. I'll have more coverage this weekend. Once again, the open thread is there if you want to contribute, if you have information that I think is valuable. So we'll include that in the show notes along with everything else. And I think that'll do it for today. James, thanks for your time.
Thanks, buddy. Take care.